And welcome in, everybody. I've been doing this as welcome in, and whenever I go back and edit the live stream, I see that in the beginning of everything. So I wanted to avoid it, and yet I still made reference to it. So I haven't managed to avoid it, but welcome in. I'm so stoked that you're here to join me talking with my friend Marybeth Kiczenski tonight. She is an Aurora chaser, and she's once famously said that she'd rather be a meth addict than an Aurora chaser because she'd have more success with meth. I think it's just because you could be as crazy as a meth addict if you're going to be an Aurora chaser. I'll let her explain that here shortly. But welcome in. We are counting down the days to the NightScaper conference. I look up at my calendar behind the camera, and we're sitting here on the 18th of April. That's one Sunday, the 25th, another Sunday, the 2nd, and then that third Sunday is the 9th, the day before the NightScaper conference. So we only have three Sundays to go before some of you will be joining me out in Kanab, Utah, and getting ready. Marybeth just pointed at herself. Who has two thumbs is going to NightScaper conference? This guy. And so she is going to be there, and many of you are going to join us through virtual conference. You're going to be there virtually. Somehow I got to find a way to chit-chat with you. I know you'll see our presentations, but I don't know how exactly I can contact you. Maybe I'll find a way with Royce. We'll figure it out. I'm sure there's a method for everyone to communicate and chat while we're there, but it is going to be 3 days of Milky Way and astrophotography discussion. I can't wait. Many of you have said that you're coming. You're going to be joining us there. Can't wait. If you haven't already decided to do it, well then go right here. Look at this. That's nightscaper.com. You can get on there and join us virtually. You have 3 weeks to make up your mind, which I would say you need 3 minutes more to make up your mind. Okay, let's listen to more of Marybeth, and then you can make up your mind. But this tonight is going to be a fantastic night talking about Aurora, so maybe I shouldn't waste any more time before getting into our main presenter, our showcase, our highlight, the woman who has taught us that Aurora in the United States, even in the middle latitudes, is possible, my guest, Marybeth Kiczenski. Hey, Marybeth, welcome in. Oh, you know what? Oh, you said hi and how are you? And I left the mute button on. But that's okay. You can recap from that. So welcome in, Marybeth.
Hi.
Good. That's perfect. That's exactly how we do it. Now when we re-record this, we can make it brilliant. So welcome in. You're coming to us from Kanab. Are you down in Kanab still?
No, actually, I'm back in the Midwest now.
You're back in the Midwest, so you're heading back to Chicago right now? Mm-hmm. I thought you were going to be down here all the way through to NightScaper, but I guess you're not that
lucky.
Oh, no, lucky.
No. I have to go to work. So, yeah. What? So sometimes I work.
Well, Marybeth, I'm stoked to have you hang out with me here tonight. With Marybeth Kiczenski joining us, we are going to learn a ton about Aurora, and I described already your famous phrase, but I butchered the paraphrasing of it. How do you always put it?
I think you got it pretty close. It's I'd rather be addicted to crack than chase Aurora.
I chose meth, I guess. I like getting skinny. Kind of
it's the same. You know, because you can find that easier sometimes.
Right. So then when you're thinking about you'd rather be crack, what is the frustration? What is it that you're feeling like you wish you had Aurora?
Yeah, the biggest frustration is its unpredictability.
Right.
We've gotten pretty good at, you know, we have satellites up there that watch the sun's activity. So we have a good idea of what it's doing, but how that translates later and, you know, when it hits the planet is a totally different story. So, and we'll get into that. But yeah, it's primarily unpredictability. It makes it really frustrating.
As goes with all Aurora discussion, other than just sharing awesome pictures, we're going to learn a little bit about how to cover some of it and follow it. Will you be able to show us some of spaceweather.com information and teach us the key elements to look for?
Sweet. I should have it up in the background here. So
awesome.
As long
fantastic.
As I didn't close it. It
there. So I heard from Kirk in a comment reply to something of yours when you were out at a famous place here in Utah that I just recently discovered where that location is. And I was going to be there if I had a vehicle in March or April, but I missed out on that. It looks like you beat me there. We won't talk about it, but that awesome grotto cave where you look out over the sand dune and the Milky Way. Oh, that's just so cool. I hadn't even heard of it until last year. Saw some pictures of it. But the thing is, you were at a bucket list location and yet you had a complaint because Kirk pointed it out and you were aware of it. How early in the night were you aware what you were missing?
Oh, wait, what?
You might not, you don't even know what I'm referring to. You were there on a beautiful night for Milky Way, but it was a Category 5, KP5.
Yes, yeah,
Aurora.
that's right. Okay, he's referring to the comment on Facebook. Yes, because it was a KP5 that night, so I was not Aurora chasing. I was at another epic location, so I can't really be mad about it.
Yeah, that's exactly right. But the crazy thing is, when was the last time you saw a KP5? Was it in March?
Know, three weeks ago.
Because of March, because of
Yeah.
the equinox, the spring equinox, you had a fantastic couple nights. So you saw a KP5 recently. But before that, I mean, it's not common, correct?
Oh, it's the middle chasing in the middle of latitudes is a bit tricky because you do need to see like something really epic, which like we'll see in some of these pictures. You do need a KP5, and the one night it made it to a six. So
Oh man.
yeah.
So you've even seen a
So
KP6 even during the solar minimum right now. You saw a
yeah.
KP6. Where was all that? I mean, we're sitting there on the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, hanging out with a workshop group, and we're just praying for like a KP2 to turn into something, and you got
I
a
know.
KP6.
I feel so bad about that, but that's how the cookie crumbles, I guess. In fact,
Yeah.
I have my UP shirt on,
You got
Detour
your
Village.
Youper. What does it
Yeah,
say? It's folded up right there. Detour.
Detour Village. It's up on the right
Oh,
over.
pull that up higher. I can barely see the top of that map. Yeah, there's the UP.
It's right over here. Yeah,
Okay.
right there.
Detour Village. I haven't been over there yet, so I have plenty of places to still visit. Well, before we waste any more time on just talking about Aurora, let's get people excited by seeing some of your work. So I'm going to go ahead and pull back to just me while you take a second to share your screen and take control over there. But everybody, I saw that there are 12 shares, so people are learning. We are joining in to learn about Aurora photography. If you're thinking, okay, I know I have a very specific question about Aurora that I need to have, make sure I see it by putting it in all caps because I'm a one-man band. I'm clicking buttons on the keyboard over here. Now I'm trying to scroll through this iPad to find chat. So just make sure you use the all caps when you ask me a question that you want Marybeth to have. So looks like you're not sharing it because I didn't give
No,
you
it's
rights to do so.
yeah.
Okay.
I was just waiting for you to get done with your statement.
You're like, he'll finish eventually. And I'm thinking, I'm just trying to stretch it out so she's ready to
I'm
go.
like, I need permission to do it.
Go go ahead, take over.
There we go.
I'm
Okay.
surprised because the thing that I answer on Zoom is allowing multiple people to do it. And I don't understand why that question's required to let only one person do it at a time. So that's bizarre. But you're getting ready. I can see that. And so for those of you who are thinking, I never done Aurora, is it this long of a shutter? Is it this situation? What lens is great? What's the way to capture it correctly? Or just how do I know when Aurora is happening so I can get out there in time? And where are the best places to go? We're gonna go through those questions tonight. And unlike previous presentations where they were all kind of strict presentations with like a pace. We are going to flow through this and have some of the Q&A right in the middle. So Mary Beth and I are going to interject. I'm going to interject her a lot as we go through, and I'm ready to bring in your questions as they come. So this is going to be a free-flowing lesson hanging out with Mary Beth tonight. So stay ready and get questions coming to me. I see that I got some comments right here, and I just got to bring them into a screen that I can see better once I know that Mary Beth is ready to go. And it looks like we are golden. Let me just bring over her picture so you can see her still from her space out there, and then I will bring you back in. So, Mary Beth, you're ready to go?
Yeah, I think so. I apologize. I don't have PowerPoint, so all my stuff is very free form.
Is there anything on your desktop you want to hide now, like any money statements or downloaded
No,
pictures of like some cute guy on the internet that we need to delete? Nothing like that?
you should be fine. There's really not too much on here.
Awesome, fantastic. Okay, Mary Beth, take it away. Get us addicted to Aurora and start our own crack addiction.
Okay, so we're gonna start off this presentation with the probably the best aurora I've seen. So this picture here is referred to as a corona, and that's when the aurora is overhead. I have never seen this before until about 3 weeks ago in Minnesota, and that's where we saw a KP6, aka G2 level storm.
Wow.
This was really cool to see, because you could actually watch it as it started to move up from the horizon, and then it went like a little bit overhead. And then before I knew it, it was like this phoenix that was just right over top of you. It was really wild.
So for people who might be brand new to Aurora, let me bring this in a little more clear. You're thinking, first time seeing this specific color of sky plus the green. No, nothing that simple. It's actually the reality of us looking at aurora is more often than not, we're looking at the crown of the globe. We're looking at the top part of the northern polar area where there's aurora happening. And then it kind of looks cool in the horizon or low on your picture and sometimes streaks up a little bit into your picture further. This was Mary Beth's first time ever to be in a position on the Earth on the border of Canada and Michigan, I guess Minnesota or Michigan?
Yeah, Minnesota.
Minnesota and Canada, where the aurora wasn't happening off in the distance. The aurora was happening on top of her, which is why it looks like she's warping into space in this picture.
Yeah, it was absolutely incredible. Like, I can't even really put into words what that was like.
Entire assignment right now is to put it into words.
Just like... It's a mind-blowing experience. I'll just put it at that. Even though we don't see the colors here, and we'll get to that because I actually edited one like you would see it. But all the structure was there, the movement, and it was just, it just kind of like moved kind of slow and like curtains, and it's, you just watch it overhead. I don't know. It was something. And I this is something more commonly seen in the high latitudes. So if you're somebody that wants to go see this, I definitely still advocate for going up to like Alaska, Norway, Yellowknife, because this is more common up there. But when it happens down here, it's extra special because it is rare. So to kind of give you an example of what we typically see down here, we're going to switch gears to this shot.
There it is. And
This is kind of more typical of middle latitude aurora. So you'll see it like on the horizon here, and the glow will extend up pretty far. But this is more typical, and it is naked eye visible. Like you could see the glow, but you just don't see the color. But this was also taken in Minnesota. This was a KP3, to put in perspective.
Oh man. Okay. So you saw something, and can you explain? When you think about, okay, KP levels, when it goes from a KP3 to a KP6, what changes typically for the aurora?
So it's going to be an element called a BZ component, primarily. Now, obviously, I'm not a scientist, so this is very high-level stuff.
Just describe it in terms of what it looks like to you, then not the science behind it.
Yeah, so like the BZ on this would be like maybe like -5-ish. I actually will bring up the space weather and we'll go through that too.
Awesome.
Whereas the corona image was -10, to kind of give you the perspective there on the difference. and when that BZ goes negative, and the further negative it goes, and if it stays there, your hemispheric power goes up. So then your auroras kind of get more and more like vibrant as that ramps up.
Are there any of those numbers you mentioned, KP or BZ, that will indicate to you that there's more chance of it reaching further south on the hemisphere?
If I usually like it around -5. So like on your BZ, if it's like -5, you'll typically see something. Obviously the more further negative that goes, you know, that's better, but.
Well, you know what, in that case, since we're getting into the weeds of kind of those terms and definitions, why don't you go ahead and do that stuff now? I've kind of pulled you into that direction. So let's explain that, and then we'll go into the pictures that give us examples of what's happening.
So
there.
Yeah, this is kind of Aurora 101. Most people know what Aurora Australis is, your southern lights centered around the south magnetic pole, and the Borealis is the northern lights. The auroral oval, which is something I always screw up pronouncing, refers to what we were talking about earlier, the oval on the top of the planet and the bottom of the planet, that where the auroras happen. And that is offset because our magnetic pole is not the same as your geomagnetic pole. So it's offset a little bit. That's why your northern tiered Midwestern states see them a lot more than, say, like Seattle, which is actually at a higher geographical location than Michigan and Minnesota is. So that's that. There's different types of energy that comes from the sun. Once coronal mass ejections, these are violent, very violent eruptions. They're more seen during solar maximums, which we're getting into. Right now, we're in a minimum. You'll often hear geomagnetic substorm, and that's just referring to the disruption of the magnetosphere based on solar winds. And these can cause power outages, interfere with radio communications and satellites, and be a health hazard to astronauts. This is why we have the satellites up there monitoring the sun. So we benefit from that as Aurora chasers, you know, being able to get this real-time data. But the real reason they're up there is for those things I just stated, because we are very heavily dependent on everything electric. So if we lost the power grid, that it's a very, very bad day. So, and then I kind of alluded to the magnetic poles. It's different than your geographical pole. And that's been shifting over time. And I actually have a little diagram for that. Plasma is your energetic electrons, you know, just stuff that comes from the sun. A solar flare, so solar flare is a little different than a CME. Solar flares are just sudden outbursts of energy, whereas a CME was a violent eruption. So they're a little different. Solar wind is a continual outflow of solar magnetic field and subatomic particles. So we're always being bombarded by a solar wind. Now, normal is 300 or 400 kilometers a second. So anytime this goes up to like 500, 600, 700 or more, that's when you'll start to see disturbances. And like actually right now, it's over 500 because we're in the middle of a CHSS, coronal hole high speed stream, which is down here.
That's easy to say.
Yeah, I know it's a tongue twister. That's why I'm like, I usually mess it up. And it's also measured in density, which is protons per centimeters cubed. So from when I'm looking at the data, a sudden uptick in that density, for example, last month, it went from like around 7 or 8, and then all of a sudden it shot up to like 43. And that's kind of indicative that of a arrival of an energetic event like a coronal hole. And that'll eventually level off, and then you'll see the solar wind speed start to elevate upward. So now we're getting to sunspots. These are areas of concentrated magnetic field on the surface of the sun. These really get going when you're in a solar maximum because that's where the magnetic field's getting all twisted because every 11 years the sun switches poles, like the north pole becomes the south pole, vice versa. So your magnetic field lines get real distorted and twisted, and the sunspots are the little footprints there. And they are the source of CMEs mostly, and also where Aurora chasers get excited because they're pretty epic events. Right now we're in a solar minimum, so we're primarily driven by these coronal holes, and they're just colder, darker areas. They can spew a lot of high speed energy at us, which we're in the middle of one right now. And then so the next couple things, we got BZ, which I alluded to. That's your orientation, your up down orientation. So the negative allows that solar wind to grab the magnetic field and allow us to see the aurora. I refer to it as the on-off switch because I've seen this happen, where as soon as that goes north, 20, 30 minutes later, you see activity just like really just die off. And the opposite happens. If it goes negative, then about 30 minutes later, you'll start to see something happen. You can get auroras with a northward BZ, but it typically requires something like a high energetic CME event, something that's going to overpower it, which hasn't happened lately. So KP, people get stuck on this number a lot. It's a measure of the global strength of a geomagnetic event. The problem is the apps pull your KP from the last 3 hours of what's been going on. So it might not be indicative of what's actually happening at that time. There's usually about a 3 hour delay. So you'll start to see that be reflected about 3 hours later. I typically would tell people to look at the solar wind speed, density, and BZ. And then look at those, and then you'll see that translate more than this KP number.
And not to rub it in on you're missing what you missed, but looking at the chat, Aniket is pointing out that yesterday was a KP5. And if I'm reading this correctly, Aniket, it was a BZ of negative 25.
Yeah, it could have been. I wasn't watching it totally. The one time I looked it up, it was minus 10 for a very long time during the day here.
Man, that's intense.
Yeah, so it was pretty good.
We spent the Upper Peninsula workshop just hoping that it would get into the negative, let alone going double
Right.
digits.
And it
Wow.
never did, but and then I
Unfortunately.
touched on solar minimum and solar maximum. So that concludes our science portion of the day. I actually do have a couple, let me see here, kind of illustrations here
While you
to
pull
show.
those up real quick, let me read some of the comments that I'm catching up on now. We got people saying that they went out and doing it themselves. And actually, Greg, he used to go to Escanaba, which is up there in the UP. Lynn was saying that they went out to Corona and they saw the Corona in Copper Harbor on March 20th. So they were there that
Oh,
time that you were near. Well, you were in
yeah.
Minnesota, but yeah. And so Adrian says during a huge storm, the Corona was visible in Madison, Wisconsin. So there's been some fantastic skies that they've seen in different areas in the northern, middle America, middle United States, that just makes me so jealous. I've seen it a couple times down here in Utah, and maybe I should let you actually see me while I'm talking so much. In Utah, I've actually captured a pano where on the northern side of my panorama, there is this annoying red pink air glow that I thought was just localized light pollution being inexperienced 5 years ago. And I kind of stopped taking my pano thinking I've got something really distracting in my image that's messing up my Milky Way panorama. And it turned out to be a fantastic aurora that was so fantastic that even in Utah, we were able to see the top high parts of the pink curtain. And I had no idea what I was seeing. I did not realize how much I should
We're
appreciate
complaining.
that. I know. I was complaining when it should have been like, wow, how lucky I am. Aniket responded and said that it wasn't yesterday during March when she captured Phoenix. Oh, I think I missed some part of that sentence. It actually doesn't make much sense to me.
That was March 20th, so about a
Okay.
month ago.
Right on. Cool. Well, you've got the coronal hole examples here. I'm going to get out of your way.
Yeah. So this is a comparison between a solar minimum and maximum, and it's pretty apparent, the difference. It's relatively quiet here. And then look at all these sunspots and twisted magnetic fields here. So this is why we see so much more during solar maximums. And but the visual of it is pretty wild. And then this one shows how the magnetic pole has been shifting over the years. And so it never stays the same. It's always because the iron core in the earth is always kind of sloshing around and moving, so your magnetic pole changes. Will it change the oval? I don't know if it actually moves enough to do that. I was trying to do some research on that. I couldn't find a straight answer, so I don't think it does. But we can find out.
That's
But
a
this is why,
lot more than I thought that it would
yeah, they have
motivate.
this is why they have to calibrate the GPS, or like the GPS systems every so often, like for airplane navigation, stuff like that. Because it does shift. And so it's different than our geographical location. This is more another illustration of the oval. Let me make it bigger. No, I guess we're
The
not wondering.
plus minus in the, yeah, there you go. Awesome.
Yeah, so you can see how it really favors the upper Midwest, like right here. So your upper tiered states, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, even up into Maine and Vermont sometimes. And then look at poor Washington State over here. Even though it's a higher latitude, it's so because here's your pole right here, and you can see how it's just offset. So us in the upper Midwest, if you're we might not have mountains, but
Yeah.
you chase Aurora.
All right, fine. You have something cool there too.
And this is another illustration of like your general KP numbers and how it translates into seeing something. So you can definitely see like KP 3 and 4 up in the very upper Midwest. 5 and 6 you start to push down, and then yeah, 9 basically your lower tiered US could even see it. But you in Utah, so yeah, I believe that night you said didn't you looked it up? It was like KP
I think it was a
7 or 8, right?
KP8. Yeah. And I'm
Yeah.
looking over
So
in the
yeah.
comments, and Eric Benedetti was out that night too. And he says Memorial Day storm back in 2016 was an incredible night. A night that I complained that I couldn't get that one guy driving in the dust over there to stop with his brake lights. That's how stupid I was about what that color was coming from. And so, what an amazing time. Willard says that Memorial Day storm was so fantastic. I caught a Steve down here in Iowa that night. So that's crazy. Amazing. Yeah.
I can't wait for that kind of activity again. I'm just blown away with the KP6 or what that I saw. I can't imagine it. Like, I really wish I was into this, like, I don't know, 10 years ago.
Yeah, back at the solar maximum. Veronica is crying. That's poor Idaho too, that doesn't get that much activity. But Aniket is saying, hey, Marybeth, well said. There's no mountains, but we have auroras. And then she has the emoji with the sunglasses. Boom.
It's like,
you guys are lucky.
Yeah, so that's kind of my little visuals I pulled from the internet to, you know, drive home some of the definitions that I put up there. So while we're on that, before we get to pictures, let me go back to my internet. Where are you?
I'm gonna go ahead and take over the screen just in case your websites or something like personal banking account and you didn't remember. No. So I just wanted to make sure that you have space weather information up before we transition back to you. But I want to say something that's in the comments that you may have not noticed who's watching right now or in a future replay. And it's something that I meant to mention in the beginning, but I got so distracted by the comments. When you're doing a one-man band thing, you can really get deterred. So I wanted to emphasize when we're sharing out to our friends that this stream was going live, was that this is a very fortunate presentation that you're a part of. Because Marybeth is not going to give a presentation at the NightScaper conference. She is a bonus educator right now. And so what we're doing here this week is, because Aurora information is so interesting to us, Royce and I thought that you'd really love learning from Marybeth Kiczenski tonight, as well as, you know, here's a bonus for you who are joining us on these pre-events that, okay, I'm going to NightScaper conference, so I didn't come to any of the pre-events. I didn't really look into it. But now those of you who have been like diligent and coming back every week, here's a bonus for you, a lesson that no one else is getting from Marybeth Kiczenski about the Aurora. So we really appreciate you doing this, Marybeth. Really love it.
I appreciate it. Maybe one day I'll get to that professional status.
Don't even start like that, because we all know that you are already a professional and you're already loved by so many people. It's insane. You're like a boy band, Korean boy band right now with how popular are your photography. They either hate you or love you.
I just love nature and night sky. So I'm glad, you know, to share it with everybody.
So other than getting our refinance at a $300,000 loan, what else can we gain from this website?
So apparently Space Weather has ads. So there's your ads. I usually don't use the website, because you can download the app, the Space Weather app, and it gives you the same information. But since we're doing a Zoom thing, I just went on the website. So now I'm going to put those definitions into visual terms here. So as right now, you can see it's a KP4, so it's actually pretty active. If I was up north, might be able to see something if it's not cloudy. I didn't check that. So your solar wind speed, it's been elevated for the past at least 24, 36 hours. And this is pretty darn good. It's close to 600, which is pretty decent. The density has leveled off. And it typically does that with coronal hole streams. Like, it'll just spike up and then it levels off. And you see the wind speed here pick up. Now down here, my favorite one. So this is kind of a mess. Based off of seeing this, I wouldn't be surprised if the only thing that's going on right now is kind of like a glow on the horizon with maybe some pillars. It's pretty much all over the place. You really want this BZ to be south, and you want it to stay south. It's bouncing all over the place right now. So it might not be as great as some of these other displays, but regardless, you'll probably see something.
Interesting. So whenever you look at this page and you see that going like a heartbeat monitor up above as often as it goes down below, it's almost as like, okay, you can't just celebrate that it goes below. You want it to go below and stay below for what extended period of time would give you confidence to go? You know, your face is frozen and your audio wasn't frozen yet, but it seems like right now your audio might be frozen. So we just have a little bit of a hotel internet glitch. Hopefully we'll have her back in a moment. Let me go through some of the questions that are coming through here while we wait for Marybeth to return. So let me go through at the very beginning and say, Royce's question was about, when is the best Aurora season? Well, let me answer that for Marybeth. Basically, when you're looking at someone's website selling Aurora season, or you're looking at information on Aurora season, you're going to hear a lot that it's this month or that month, but you never hear stuff in the summer. It's not because the Aurora only shows up in the winter. Just like the Milky Way core, it doesn't just show up certain times of the year. It's the timing with the light of the sun that it works out only in certain months. And since we have such a perfect pattern as we're rotating and cycling through, that perfect pattern causes it to come back consistently during certain months. So to put it this way, if you're thinking about Aurora only up in the northern latitude areas, you're also dealing with a season in the middle of the year that they have so much light that the sun never sets below. Basically, we are at an angle that has what happens. The sun is shining on that land, but then it doesn't actually work yet where you can actually see a dark enough sky to pick up Aurora. But then when the sun starts finally going below the horizon at those northern latitude lines and give you a full night of not just astro twilight, but full darkness, then the Aurora starts becoming visible. It happened possibly every day throughout that summer, but because it never got dark enough to show it off, the best times to go were during those winter months where the sun goes low enough below the horizon that it gets dark enough. So just so you know, in the background, we got Mary Beth. She has returned. Your computer, let's make sure I can hear you. Yeah, I can hear you.
I got abruptly cut off. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, that's all right. Your face froze for about 30 seconds of talking. And so I thought, your video's going out. That's not a problem. You did have kind of a concerned look on your face.
I was like, what is going on?
Go ahead and get back into your screen and I'll just continue this definition of the timing. So this situation of dealing with summer months only having no aurora is just where the sun doesn't go down. It's just you want a nice long dark night, and it's the best time to go when it's really, really dark. And so the winter months are typically more popular in, say, Iceland, Lofoten, Norway, up in those areas that just never have a darkness during the summer periods. With Milky Way, we have the same thing. That Milky Way core is going around the Earth, and we see it every day. The problem is sometimes it's during the day. And so when you think about a season for Milky Way or a season for Aurora, the reality is that we're rotating and we see it all the time, the Milky Way core, and the Aurora can happen anytime. You just got to hope that it's dark and ready to go when you have that opportunity, which is why the only month that you can't see the Milky Way core on pretty much everywhere in the entire world is December. When you think about a month that you can't see it, it's December, but every other month has at least minutes of the core visible above your horizon during some dark hour, some dark time. So let's go back into your screen. You were going to show us more on BZ North and BZ South. The last thing you said basically was that you were going to give us an idea of how long it should be under negative before we go. And I think you answered that question, but just start from around there.
Okay. Yeah. So what you're seeing here is kind of like a really bouncy BZ. So this can be kind of frustrating. So I'm going to unshare the screen real quick because I'm going to show you my cell phone. So this, let's see if you can see this.
Just tilt it down a little bit more.
Okay, yeah. Like that?
Yep, we can see that.
This was March 20th. So you see how far north and then all of a sudden it tanked?
Yeah.
So I'll show you the next screen here. And then look how far it stayed south.
Oh, wow.
So that's kind of really what you want.
Is that graph still a 24-hour period or is that just a couple hours?
A couple hours.
Okay.
It's just like half-hour increments. So like... yeah, so like, as soon as it tanked like that, about like 30 minutes later, we started seeing some real nice activity. So yeah, I had to screenshot that for future reference, you know. All right, so we'll go back into sharing this. But I wanted to give you the comparison because this is what's going on right now versus something like pretty spectacular that happened about a month ago.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, that's kind of the visuals on that. And I think that is the end of my very basic high level science lesson. I hope you guys can, you know, kind of catch on to that and wasn't too confusing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it is always a slog through the weeds of all the scientific terms, but that's what I'm here for. I'm here to act as the, you know, advocate for those watching. So when you're thinking about becoming an Aurora chaser, you mentioned the app recently, so let's start there. What's the one app called that they should have?
The one that I use primarily is space weather app. It just I use it because it gives you the data and you can just look at it, interpret it that way. There's a couple other ones out there, but they tend to be really optimistic. We'll just say that. Like, there's another one that said it'll be like a KP 7 or 8, and it was nowhere near that really. So I usually just drive people to Space Weather app because that's probably the most accurate in my opinion. So.
Is that also your app for knowing when the aurora is good? Because I know you're looking at the data, but I'm talking like anything that it alerts you. Does it alert you that, hey, the KP is up? Or
Yeah, you can sign up for at alerts. And also you can do that's real time. You can also do the forecast.
Okay.
So it'll lay it out in days, and then this one has the moon overlay on it. You can get this in the app too. So everything on this website is in the app.
Cool. So unlike Milky Way photography, where you can say, okay, I'm going to go out on June 14th because that's a good night. The moon shouldn't be up much. I'm going to go out that night. You can't plan aurora like that. How do you handle that?
You really have to look at this app, and then, believe it or not, the moon isn't necessarily a bad thing. And I actually have a picture to show with that too. Full moon at middle latitudes can be a challenge. I typically don't go out in the full moon. It really has to be a good showing for it to overpower it. I've seen some really beautiful images from way far north during a full moon, but you're like underneath it, so it's a little different. I have seen it anywhere from about half to new moon, and it's been fine. So the moon isn't a total deal breaker. Full moon might be, at these southern latitudes. So I tend to not get excited if something happens during full moon, at least down here.
Show us that example image. I want to see that one.
Oh, yeah. So it's buried in the trio here. So this middle one right here was taken during the moonlight. And what was kind of nice about it is it lit the foreground up. That's your positive thing with shooting in moonlight, is you get the nice light on the foreground. It is subdued quite a bit, but to me that gave it that kind of Arctic feel because it's real pastel-y. So that was shot in moonlight. These other two flanking it was shot with no moon. So kind of gives you that difference there.
Before your experience in Minnesota, were these some of your most bright horizons? Because you see the difference between horizon aurora and above your head aurora.
Oh yeah. Like this, both of these images on the ends were taken March 13th and 14th. So the week prior.
Oh, that same month though.
Yeah, it was the same month. This was the week prior. Actually, this was the beginning of the night, the one with the rock and the tree. And this was at the end of the night. So this was taken around 4:30 AM. It was actually quite a spectacular show in the middle there. And that's what this next trio should have, or actually, no, not this trio.
But those were awesome. You have to come back to those.
Yeah, I will. This one. So this was taken the same night as those two images that were flanked in the last slide. But this was taken during the peak of that particular show. And I thought I was like, this was the greatest thing ever until the following week. Because this was the first time where I could actually start to see some of the pink color that's in these, down here along these ridges here. And you can kind of see it in here. And I've never been able to pick up the color before until that night. You can sort of see the green, and you can really see the green this night because it was really bright. But that was pretty spectacular. While I have this slide up, I'll show you something here. So this is kind of managing expectations, right? Because people see these images like, oh my God, all those colors.
Yeah, exactly.
However, our human eyesight isn't that good at night. So typically, this is kind of what it's going to look like. Now, depending on the intensity, you might see some green in there, or like I was able to pick up a hint of pink. But typically, this is what you expect to see naked eye. It's a lot of gray tones, but very bright pillars. And you can actually see the definition here. You can watch it move. It's very easy to see. You're just missing all that vibrant color that the camera can pick up.
And I can vouch for seeing that move in the night sky and how exciting that gets. You're like, oh my gosh, I think that might be aurora. It's moving. It definitely looks like aurora. You get that picture taken and then it pops off green. You're like, yes.
Yep, there it is.
So coming from the chat, I have a question that's going to lead us into a longer discussion, and I'm going to preface that question with another question, then we'll go into that question, which makes no sense now that I said it out loud. But Chris said, just saw a quick Pigeon Falls Aurora. That's on the bucket list. Is that Pigeon Falls there on the left
side? That is Pigeon Falls. That when I saw the data like go really nice like that, I hightailed it over there because that was a bucket list shot, and it's got to be pretty decent because, you know, it's pretty high up, you know, it's not really on the horizon. I definite bucket list shot.
So location is definitely everything, but let's talk about the specifics of the gear. I don't want you to go in too long, but quickly answer the question for those who are thinking, I've done astrophotography, I've done Milky Way photography. Is there anything in my current gear that is not going to work? I mean, if you thought of telling someone what they need for Aurora, can they use their Milky Way photography gear for Aurora?
Yes, you can. Actually, that's perfectly fine. I have recently been using a modified camera to shoot these with. Actually, that's why, I don't know if you can see this, but the California Nebula is like popping off here. Because that shot with a modified Z6. And same with those. Actually, these are all shot with the Z6. Let me see if I have anything shot with the D850.
Show us what some of us poor people have. I mean, what's our situation?
This one. So this one on the end here was shot with a regular camera. It's perfectly fine. It's just, if you can actually look from comparing this one to this one, it just, the H alpha modified camera just picks up more of that red.
Do you think the red was that strong on the right image, or was it just washed?
It might have been subdued a little bit in here, you know, but it definitely picks up more with the modified camera. I mean, it just.
Okay. Cool. So thinking about that camera gear that you already have, everybody, you can use it as is. You just need to have a tripod, go out there and shoot wide open, you know, use a lens that has, you know, giant, you know, 1.4, you know, get a 1.4 aperture and you got a sweet setup. But just go for something as big as you can, a bigger light bucket. Now, Roz asks you, what about camera settings? Where you shot some of these images, give us an example of settings with each image.
Okay. So if you're, for starters, I always tell people to start with your basic Nightscape exposure. So like ISO 6400, 15 seconds, F2.8 or whatever the lowest, you know, F-stop that you have. And then look at it and see what you have, adjust from there. If it's really bright Aurora, you don't have to really shoot those high ISOs. You can drop that down. Like this was probably, I think this was shot at 2000. And then also you can start to play with the shutter speed. Because I wanted to capture more of the motion here, like freeze it. This was a 6 second exposure. And then just to compare on how bright this was done at 2 seconds. Wow. And it really freezes these pillars like that. And it was bright enough that I actually had to drop the shutter speed down. Otherwise it was blowing it out. So really it kind of depends on your, you know, what's going on, but you know, like your typical, horizon Aurora, that's kind of just glowing. You can get away with like 15, 20 second exposures and you'll capture the color. You'll see, cause a lot of the detail just really isn't there. But if you really want to capture that, the freeze, those pillars, drop that shutter speed down. It makes a difference, and then you can adjust your ISO accordingly. You can go up or down, you know, based on how dark the image is. But it was so bright this night that it really, this was, I think was ISO 2000. I shot it at F2 and then 6 sec, or this was 2 seconds. The other one was 6 seconds.
Does anything dictate to you a setting that you should change outside of just how much the Aurora is moving?
Like,
so for instance, you're thinking about a setting change. You've mentioned different settings. Has it only been because of movement in the Aurora?
Yeah, most movement and brightness.
Brightness. Both. Just if you go for too long a seconds and you realize it's way too overblown, you just go back down.
Yeah, you just go back down. And then like it's, okay. And then you look, if you're the type that likes to freeze the motion, then you want a shorter shutter speeds. If you like that kind of glowy feel, then go for the longer ones. I've experimented with tracking with it. I don't have it on here. I don't think.
Bummer. I'm surprised you only have like 7 images here. You have so many.
Okay. I know.
You should start opening up your Instagram.
Yeah, let me actually let me
While
just
you
mute.
do that, Chris was, or actually no, Chris is answering the question. Lynn asked, "Do you need permission to be at Pigeon Falls after the park's closing hours?"
You're that's kind of
It's a good question.
open-ended. I didn't get yelled at. I heard the guy before me had a talking to. But when they found out that he was just there taking pictures, it was okay. So I think they're kind of, do I
Wait,
really
real
got
quick. Don't
to
type that in. Don't type that in. Let me just switch over to me so that you can type
Yeah,
in privacy.
just over to you.
Adrian says, you know what? Some of these parks will stay open all night. For me, it has been trial and error. And I agree with Adrian.
Yep.
Go and do it. If you're not bringing like a workshop or you're going there to make a commercial with, on location with the film crew, you're not doing anything wrong. If you are, they'll let you know and you can leave. You can't get away with a workshop without getting permission. But if you personally, I mean, you can go to places that have banned headlights and all that, headlamps and all the lights on the rocks, and you can get away with a lot of stuff. Now, I guess it sounds like I'm saying break all the rules. My point is go and do it. And if someone says to leave, respect that and go. There's nothing else that you need to worry about. Now, you dropped out of sharing your screen. Did you not want to go into Instagram right now? Should I do it on my end?
Oh yeah, I thought you were gonna pop it up.
Okay,
So
cool. Let me go back into
that's why
you.
I stopped.
Oh, no worries. I'm gonna go back into you so you can answer this other question that we have. When you're thinking about beginners into Aurora photography, they've gotten used to Milky Way photography. What would you tell them that they need to make sure they have or do? Is there anything for ideal situation that they should train on or buy that would help them with Aurora photography?
Just basically just know your camera. Like the same rules of Milky Way stuff applies to this as well. Like, know your how to focus at night, your basic exposure settings, get a really nice tripod, that can handle like, conditions. And you should be fine. There's really nothing much too different other than Aurora is a lot more unpredictable and doesn't follow a schedule. It's not out every night. But your basic ideas behind night photography is kind of the same, just
What's
depending on the video.
the one big thing you've learned by trial and error that you would advise? Like, hey, this is what I learned after a year of doing it wrong. Make sure you don't do this. Is there anything that stands out?
Not particularly different than just the regular stuff. I had a lot of trial and error with Milky Way, and really all that stuff translated over to this. So, I can't really think of anything offhand.
No worries. It's one of those things in the last, in this kind of situation that stands out. So there's things that we learn, the experiences that we have when going out that you change a little bit, but basically the stuff that you've already shared has already gone through those changes. So I understand what you're saying. What would be your dream? What's left for you in Aurora photography? As I scroll right now through your Instagram, I know everybody, it's hard to see everything here. So what you should do is just go right now to your Instagram and go and subscribe and follow to Marybeth Kaczynski. Her Instagram is at Shelby Diamond Star. Shelby Diamond Star. It was a name that she used when she was a ballerina. Okay, no. This is her car mixed with another car. Is that what it is?
Yeah, that's what it is. It's two car names put together. So
Okay,
Shelby Automobiles, Diamond Star Motors. Boom.
Diamond Star Motors is the one I'm not familiar with. So
Yeah.
Shelby Diamond Star, that's her Instagram. Follow it now. And if nothing else, just give her a thank you by following her Instagram. And you can see all these images in greater detail. And as I'm scrolling through here and seeing awesome images, I'm asking you, what is something that you still are lacking? What's your next Aurora-like bucket list item?
Gosh, I that's that I have to think about it. Like, I just want to, continually experiment around with it. Obviously it's a dream to, go further north, to see,
Yeah.
it overhead like all the time and some of those epic locations up there. I guess for me, like being able to ex find more places to shoot it at. Like the waterfall was really awesome. I want to find more locations kind of like that. Because when I first started, I would shoot just over Lake Superior, which is cool, but it's kind of lacking that storytelling aspect to it.
Right.
So, I really want to explore more of both Minnesota's North Shore and the UP and find more of these, you know, different intimate scenes that you can shoot Aurora with, where it becomes more secondary, not the primary element, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Kind of like the lighthouse shot. Actually, if you have the Instagram up, because I don't know why I don't have that one on here.
Oh, yeah. Let me go ahead and pull it up. I was just on the screen that you guys aren't seeing. I was pulling up spaceweather.com because you showed spaceweather live for a lot of information.
Yep.
I do like spaceweather.com for some of the information that you can get, like the stories. Well, you might recognize this one from March 20th, 2021. This is when Mary Beth was featured on spaceweather.com. And in this information, you get the coronal hole and the sun information for sunspots, as well as scrolling down, you can get to the oval and how it's looking currently. Now, this is on March 20th. In fact, no, that's not correct. Is it? Yeah, it is correct, because they do show this on the archive as well. So if I were to go to the current date, let's see what tonight is doing. But I wanted to show that you were featured there on spaceweather.com because your image was so amazing. So this is why we're lucky to have Mary Beth spend some time today in the middle of her trip down to the Outsiders Conference and between her, you know, next one for the NightScaper Conference. So currently, you mentioned already that was pretty good. It says it's KP4 unsettled, and they sell things that they put into space. So yeah, you can see that. Yeah. But some of
there's actually another image they featured. Man, a couple. I wish I knew the date. But the one I was looking for to bring up was the Steve.
The Steve? Lady. Is that the lighthouse one you're referring to? There's a lighthouse one
and then the Steve. And the most recent Steve
that looks like a light beam that's shining through the earth.
That one.
Yep, I got it up right now. This is intense.
Because that is a tracked and stacked shot that I processed in PixInsight.
Is this the only Aurora that you've tracked? Because you usually don't track Aurora.
No, I usually don't, because you want to capture, you know, the motion. But this Steve was, it just stayed there. And it stayed there. And it was, and I was like, you know what? If it's going to stay there, I'm going to track this thing and experiment around with it. So I did 5 different 1-minute exposures on it and then ran it through PixInsight and processed it that way. So like, it really brought out a lot of the color and that Milky Way behind it.
Yeah, that is gorgeous looking. That's the northern band of the Milky Way for us in the hemisphere, and it looks awesome.
Yeah, so that's like one of those, when you talk about experimenting with photography, that was one of those experiments. Like, I normally don't track Aurora, but sometimes the conditions might be like, hey, you know, let's give this a shot.
This thing is amazing. I know Steves are unique, and you've actually captured 2 now.
Yeah, it's okay. So Steves are interesting. They actually tend to be more common at your middle latitudes. So a lot of people down in Alberta, Canada, the Midwest, and you know, over in some of their other areas like Scotland, actually tend to see them quite often, more so than I guess in other areas. They are really cool to see. It's that one that night, like, spanned from horizon to horizon. You could just see it overhead. It was really cool.
Wow.
The only thing missing in that image is what they refer to as the picket fencing, which is like little green lights that kind of follow that same path that it's going.
Huh.
It wasn't in that image. It was in a Steve that came out earlier that I missed. actually, it was if I share the screen again.
Go ahead. And while you do that, I'll just show them this in nice big form again, because I kind of mixed his screen down small. Just remember spaceweatherlive.com, spaceweather.com, and the app was the Space Weather app. You get that app, you have everything you need to go track Aurora. And if you get on those websites from your couch, those are the great websites to go to. Because I can't see in the background, are you ready to go with that screen?
Yes. Yep.
Awesome. Okay, let me get this out of everyone's way. Oh, I'm clicking on the wrong window. And now I see your screen. Nice. Okay, here we go.
So this middle one with the trees, that's actually the Steve that came out earlier, but I missed the primary where it was brighter.
Oh, I see.
But you can see this green right here, very faintly kind of coming off right here. That's the picket fencing that they refer to. Now, that was much brighter about, I don't know, 3 minutes earlier.
Dang, you missed it by 3 minutes.
Missed it by that much. But I wanted to show that picture and, you know, in comparison to the other one, because this is a feature that is typically found with Steves. That's sort of in this one, but I missed the primary, you know, show of that one.
Well, we're nearing the end of our Q&A. So everyone, this is your last call for any new questions you'd like to ask Mary Beth that maybe we didn't mention. But here's one that comes from Eric Benedetti. His question is, best place in the lower 48 for Aurora imaging?
I like Minnesota and the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. The reason I like the Upper Peninsula is because the whole North Shoreline, since I'm sharing my screen, we'll just...
Well, don't log into Facebook. Okay, good.
Oh, I'm not going to log. I'm just going to go to Google Maps here and zoom out. If I can zoom out, that would be great. But I'm so bad with these Macs. I'm sorry.
You're getting better. Like, two fingers. Slide it out. Two fingers slide out. So then... As I'm looking at the chat, everybody, get us the Q&A questions that you have that you want coming. And it's cool to see that Royce and I had the same question on our mind. Apparently, he even asked the Aurora bucket list question and why. And I asked that, Royce, entirely without knowing that that question was in your chat. So you and I, man, we're on the same wavelength. I love that. So we got a couple questions coming in. Remember to hit us up before we need to go to the final question coming from our OG Nightscaper, Royce Bear. But go back into what you were showing us on the map. Okay. Which I guess, holy crap, that's a lot of places that you've want to go or have gone.
I tend to go to these areas. So I wanted to show you because the Upper Peninsula here, so this entire shoreline is north facing, like due north. And you're looking over Lake Superior. So there's nothing on the horizon. So I love going up here for aurora chasing because of that reason. You have nothing in the way. It's north facing my favorite areas up here on the tip here, Copper Harbor. Because that's the darkest spot in Michigan. Now, when you look over here in Minnesota, that the oval actually favors this area a little bit more, but you have to work a little harder to find a northern facing spot. They have a lot of inland lakes, which is really beautiful. And so most of the people in Minnesota tend to go to the inland lakes, like up the Gunflint Trail. There's a lot of them up there. And it's very dark in this area too. Northern Wisconsin also works, also because they have this northern facing shoreline here. They're just a little bit further south, and you have a little bit more light pollution to deal with, like from Duluth here, and some of these towns up here. So that's my preference, is the UP and then northern Minnesota over here.
Awesome. Roz was asking, what time of night do you need to go out?
Okay, yeah, that's a good question. I didn't hit on that. So aurora can happen at any time. The oval tends to get over this area. So like usually between midnight and 2 a.m. I find to be kind of like the prime spot, but I have seen them from sunset to sunrise before. And then I've seen them come out at 3 a.m. where it was nothing all night. I've seen them at right as the sun sets till about 11 p.m. and then it fizzles out. But it seems like the sweet spot, as long as the data is good, is usually between midnight and 2 a.m.-ish for this area, because that oval swings down over it before it kind of goes up and over. So that's my unofficial answer there.
Unofficial. This is a formal official declaration from Mary Beth Kaczynski right now. So it looks like we don't have any new questions coming in. I have a comment from Royce that for some reason this screen has stretched it out beyond my window. And so I'm just trying to get it so that I can see the whole one. So it says, you are much like the rest of us Milky Way chasers, when it comes to the aurora chasing experience. When we first start out, we are just excited to get a photo of the Milky Way or an aurora. As we become more experienced, we want to see more. Thank you, Facebook. Capture images with an interesting foreground that tells a story. So as I fumbled through reading that, he says, you're just like all of us Milky Way photographers who we first were like, holy crap, that sky is amazing. Cool sky, but boring foreground. Yeah. Then we merge into that, starting to make our foregrounds fantastic. Are there any foregrounds to you that are your absolute favorite?
This one that I'm showing on the screen right now.
Oh, really? Specifically?
I have this real love for rocks and trees, like on rock formations. So this is northern North Shore Minnesota, and I saw this during the day once and I just fell in love with it. So I had to go back and shoot the Milky. This was actually that same week with the aurora, but this was a night of no aurora. But I'm really drawn to rocks and trees on rocks. So this particular image is one of my favorites.
It is really cool to see that. I mean, for something that does exactly opposite of what I typically do, because you're blocking the Milky Way core, it's still an amazing image.
So that's my, I don't know. I like trees. I used to never say that because trees are a real bear to blend, but I've gotten better over time with it. And, you know, actually, because Eric's on this chat, he's been very helpful in, you know, tips and tricks on blending trees. So it's gotten better. It's gotten easier. So now that it's gotten easier, I seek out trees.
That's insane. So let's go to the final questions before we go into the Royce Bear final word. With this picture up, oh, you just turned it off.
Oh, here, let me, I'll put it up.
Unfair. Yeah, take over again. I will put it back up again. Okay. All right. Chris says, photo on the screen. That is the Lake Superior on the Minnesota side, right?
Yes, that is correct. It's in, it's by Grand Marais, northern Minnesota.
Secrets. She's sharing secrets.
Well, I didn't tell exactly where it is, but it's up in that area.
Fantastic. Awesome. Randy says, what year do we shift into the maximum for the 11-year cycle?
We're going into it now. Actually, I read an article yesterday that they said it's overperforming right now. So now they are predicting the peak to happen in 2024 instead of 2025. So from every year on out until 2024, it should just get more and more exciting.
Oh, awesome. Yep, it's a good time to be alive going forward with better tech. And Eric Benedetti says, gosh, I hate trees. I didn't give that full credit because I didn't give him the full word, but man, he hates trees and I don't blame him. Royce Bear asked, Mary Beth, are you going to be a speaker at the 2021 Aurora Summit?
Ooh, that's a, I should probably inquire about that. I guess not right now, but I know, I know Melissa has asked me about it and then I never got back to her.
Now, Mary Beth is a humble person. You're welcome. Royce, thank you, Royce. Mary Beth's a humble person, but she hasn't mentioned this once because she just won't do it herself. But there was an article recently out there on, I think, the world's best Aurora photographers, and you were in the top 20 list. Is that a best way to describe that?
Oh, yeah, it was that Capture the Atlas. He featured a picture from the UP in that list.
That's awesome. Praveen asks, have you been to the Southern Hemisphere to chase Aurora yet?
No, I would love to. I would love to do the Milky Way down there too.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
I guess New Zealand's a pretty good spot for that.
Aurora Australis.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be wonderful.
Adrian says 2024, remember, is also the year of the great American total solar eclipse. So if you missed you know, back in 2017 or was it 2018? It was 2017 that it happened. If you missed it then, here's your chance again in 2024, which used to seem so far away, but right now it is crazy that it's only 3 years out.
Yeah, it's not that far away, so.
Awesome. Okay, well, let's go into the OG Nightscaper, Royce Bear's final word. And I started it without actually showing it yet, so now I will click it. Let's just take two. Can I try it again? Okay, thank you, thank you. And now we'll go into the OG Nightscaper, Royce Bear's final word.
Hi, Aaron. Hi, Mary Beth. Great to be here with everyone tonight. Although I'm actually recording this in my Kanab, Utah hotel room on Friday. In fact, I just ran into Mary Beth a few minutes ago, who was with a couple of her friends. Small world. In a minute, I'm going to ask Mary Beth one last question, so don't go away. I'm here to remind everyone of the Nightscaper Conference, which is now only a few weeks away, on May 10th through 12th. This is a hybrid conference with 150 safely attending in person and hundreds more attending virtually. We have over 40 speakers from 10 different nations giving over 70 programs and panel discussions. 30 of those speakers will be at the Kanab Center in Utah to personally make their presentations in front of a live audience and answer questions. So you'll get to feel all the synergy of people coming together in these live broadcasts. All of this is being recorded and archived into the cloud, where you'll get to refer and replay it for up to a year. Virtual tickets are available at nightscaper.com, or you can also go to roycebear.com. Mary Beth, you travel a lot to the Western United States, especially here in my amazing state of Utah. But lately I've noticed a returning pride, even a passion to rediscover the hidden treasures in the state of Michigan, right in your backyard. Tell us more about that. What is rekindling this? And do you have any plans to share your new Michigan vision with others? I've heard those plans might even go beyond what you're sharing on social media.
So Royce is asking you, Mary Beth, about that Michigan vision that you have of sharing that area. And he implies that there's something that you're doing maybe outside of social media, and you have a mission or a plan for it. What is it that you're doing? What are you? Oh, right now I'm showing you in a funny screen. Let me just go to gallery view because I was overlapping you. But what is your plan? You've been really pumping up Michigan and especially the Mackinac Bridge. So what's your goal? You really love that area. And I think I'm falling in love with it too.
Yes, I do. It's funny because I grew up in Michigan, south of Detroit. And I never, ever appreciated that area. We would go up north every year and it just, you know, was like, whatever. I have to think getting into photography and specifically landscape photography, it really opened up my eyes to just how beautiful the Great Lakes region is. It's awfully overlooked, which I don't know, maybe that's a good thing. Because as much as I really adore Utah, which you know, Royce alluded to, it's a wonderful state and I love it. There is this like subtle beauty to the Great Lakes region, and doing this landscape photography, this Aurora photography, Milky Way has really, really made me appreciate this, essentially my own backyard. So that's kind of, you know, how that came to be. And you can tell, you know, like I talk about it all the time and how much it's, how great it is. And what he was alluding to, secondly, it was I am trying to work on a book project. Documenting the night skies that are up there and like, you know, how you can see the Aurora and in Milky Way and, you know, different times of the year with the snow and stuff like that. It's very early on. We'll see what happens, but, every month I go up there and collect images. So I'm hoping to kind of chronicle these adventures and put them into a book and, you know, just really showcase that area. Cause I think it's a really special place.
Oh man, the UP has a special place in my heart now, and I was skunked when I was there. So can't even imagine what it will be like when I'm actually there with Aurora happening.
Yeah. So it's dear to my heart and I'm very happy to have rediscovered it, even though I've lived in the area my whole life.
So rediscovered. So is it fair to say that I might have an Aurora book from Marybeth Kiczenski that's on my coffee table someday?
Someday.
Someday. Could be 10 years from now, could be two. Of course,
someday.
10 years from now, you'll be not taking any pictures. You'll be I should say you're not writing anything because you'll be outside all the time with Aurora.
That's right.
So then before everyone goes, what would be your final advice for anyone who wants to do Aurora? What do we need to summarize as absolutely do this and you can go and capture these images?
Okay, so my final advice, which I tell everybody, is don't ever plan a trip solely for Aurora, because it is unpredictable. It can look good and then not happen in this. So what I used to say is go up north, go wherever for the landscapes, for the night sky, the clear skies, you know, do some Milky Way, but turn that camera north and just see what's going on. I've caught them several times just by turning your camera north and doing a test shot. It's like that. Cause you know, sometimes you don't have signals. You can't check stuff.
Right.
So I have caught them by accident that way. So always do a test shot north because you never know. And actually, when you get better at seeing it, you can actually see this glow. And it almost looks like light pollution on the horizon. But you're looking over Lake Superior, you're like, maybe not. And then it has like a slight motion to it. So if you're seeing that glow with some motion to it, odds are it's Aurora. Do a test shot, see if the color shows up. But it's absolutely addicting to chase. I'm totally like just all in on it. But when you see it, it'll hook you like crazy, but just be prepared for the, cause for every time you see it, there's three failures or more. So you do have to, that's why I always say, go up for the night skies, do Milky Way. And then Aurora's a bonus.
Awesome. And don't get too stressed out when you're that crack addict looking for another fix and it just won't come.
Yep, it will eventually. If you do it enough, you will catch it. But yeah, just stay positive over it, because once you do see it, it'll change you forever.
Absolutely. And as it was pointed out in the chat, if you follow Mary Beth on Instagram, you'll actually be alerted to nights that are fantastic. So follow Mary Beth wherever you can. Where are the best places to follow you that I haven't mentioned yet?
Oh, yeah. So Instagram, Shelby Diamond Star is also my Facebook page. Those are my two main sources. I do have a website, which is shelbydiamondstar.com. But I haven't been the best at updating that. I should write more. But I have been trying to keep up on doing the stories with Instagram. Like the other day I posted up about the data looking pretty good for people who may watch, you know, the stories, even though I was nowhere near to see it. But, you know, maybe it helped. I think a couple of people said it helped them out a little bit. So I'm trying to get better with that. You know, just putting out a quick little blast.
You don't have a YouTube channel yet, do you?
Oh, yeah. I'm trying to work on that, too.
Come on.
You, Kirk, and a couple of people. I'm going to try to clean out a room in the house, so that way I have something good. Cool, like your background there. I'd be more apt to do something like that if I had a good space.
Yes, please do it.
And if I do get a YouTube channel up, it's going to be the same name. So Shelby Diamond Star. I'm trying to keep it all the same.
Well, let's go to the final thank yous from the chat so that they can get the message across to you. What I'm thinking. Thank you so much, Mary Beth, for being a part of this. Adrian says, as a Michigander, I think I should say it. I don't think I should put so much accent on Gan. Michigander, I'd love to join you in this quest and salute you for showing everyone about our great state. So Adrian Bradley, he wants to join you on that images for a Michigan Aurora.
Yeah.
And he says, we won't talk about our COVID numbers, though. Nah, we won't mention that.
Yeah, I heard it's kind of a mess there right now.
Don't worry. No. We don't have to talk about Gretchen Whitmer and all that right now. Yeah. Let's just focus on the apolitical, awesome astrophotography. And then Alan Dyer, a man who is an awesome photographer from Canada, who said he was enjoying, you know, Aurora week last week. He says, thank you all. An inspiring presentation from Mary Beth. So good props to you, Mary Beth. Steven says,
I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah, he was hanging out for her. Steven says, bravo, Mary Beth. Keep inspiring. And Niket says, do not use KP is the best advice. Follow that BZ. Tanya says, great info. Amazing pics. Thank you so much for sharing. Coming from Royce, great to see you here, Alan. Oh, he's talking to Alan. He was also great to see Mary Beth, I'm sure. And then
that's the other day.
Lynn says, thank you so much. You are an inspiration, with a big old heart emoji. I'm looking over my mic to see all the chat. Thank you so much from Veronica. Thank you from David. Thanks from Eric Benedetti. Thank you from Jeremy. And Aniket says, thank you for inspiring. Keep us updated on Instagram at Aurora. So thank you so much, Mary Beth. And thank you, everybody who was here tonight and shared and hung out. Next week, we return with the man who hates trees, Eric Benedetti.
I can't wait for that one.
Oh, I know.
Eric's an awesome guy. You guys will enjoy that. He's a super inspiring guy. One of the many that has helped me in this journey. So, you know, definitely come back for that.
Yep. Eric Benedetti and Bryony Richards will be here next week, Sunday night, 7 p.m. Mountain Time. So come back for another Nightscaper pre-event. And in the meantime, I'll read some more of these as we go into the goodbye. So thank you, everybody. I hope you guys all have a great night.
Glad you enjoyed it.
You did a fantastic job.
Okay, good, because it's like super informal.
Well, if this is what you're like informal, man, imagine if you had a full presentation. This would be killer.
Yeah, when I actually organize something, I need to get I am actually trying to do something. Like I need to get like a studio space, you know, set up like that.
Not soak up all the hotel bandwidth.
Yeah, apparently I had to put it on my phone hotspot to bring it back.
Really? Oh wow, this is going pretty well in your phone hotspot.
Yeah, so I'm pretty impressed with that. But I need to get PowerPoint and stuff like that, because I just don't have it. And then I didn't want to say it on. We're not live anymore, right?
Oh, you thought we weren't?
Okay.
We still are. We are, and we're talking to everybody right now. That's funny, because the way you said all of that, I was like, I better not hit the graphic yet, because Mary Beth has something big to say, but she had no idea. She had no idea that she's live. Oh, hilarious.
I thought that was the end. I'm sorry, guys. But
you didn't say anything offensive.
But I do want to say, since everybody's here still, you know, thanks for joining in, because like it's super informal, and I hope that you got something out of this, because you know, I get great joy out of this. So if it helps somebody else in the journey, I really just, that's all I hope for. So, and if you have any questions, you can hit me up anytime. I try my best to answer them.
She is so good about that. Definitely can vouch for that. And I'm glad that we went a little longer to hang out with you there. That was fun to see. I'm even blushing now. I'm feeling bad for you. I thought you had something you still wanted to say. So I'm like, don't hit the button yet, Aaron. She's saying something important.
No, I don't have anything to say.
Thanks, guys, for hanging out with us. Get out there to the virtual conference if you haven't already. And we'll see you next Sunday night at 7 p.m. with Eric Benedetti and Briny Richards. And I'll wave one more time. See you, everybody. All right, the desktop audio is off, so we can't hear me.